Okay, so welcome. It's so good to see you. If we put it together, and welcome back to New York from your travels and everything like that.
Well, Harold, thank you for having
me.
And
I'm really looking forward to this. I'm going to be learning, so bear with me. But and everything. And in the audience, welcome very, very much to Conversations. A great pleasure. Welcome to the program. David Fisher. David Fisher is a writer, and he's been a very, very what would be called a successful writer. He's had 15 or 17 actually best-selling books that he's written that have appeared, I guess, on the New York Times list, and a great number of others. He's very busy. He's got a wide inquiring mind, and he's a very interesting person. And David, welcome very, very much to Conversation.
Well, Harold, thank you for having me.
Share with me. We've met over the fact that you guys have gotten involved, as I have been, in a loose way with a fellow, Reed Stowe, and so forth.
Exactly.
And everything. But would you share your own personal background? Born and raised, educated a little bit.
Well,
and then we'll talk about writing. The media mix between writing and literature and multimedia and so forth and so forth. But could you share your own background? Born and raised, educated.
Well, I'm a New Yorker.
Okay.
I'm born on 88th Street.
Mm-hmm.
Grew up on Long Island.
88th East or what?
88th East.
Okay.
It was Doctor's Hospital at that point.
Okay, good.
Yeah. And grew up on Long Island.
Mm-hmm.
And lived in Manhattan for a great part of my life, and
mm-hmm.
when I got married, moved to the Bronx, moved to Riverdale.
Yeah, Riverdale's kind of far up, right? Out
near
Yonkers. I had
actually, we live on what is literally the last block in New York City.
Might as well be at the edge, huh?
Well, it's fabulous. It's a one-lane road.
Uh-huh.
I mean, two cars can't pass at the same time.
No kidding.
Covered, you know, tree covered. It really
you have
is.
Cows around in it?
We're right across the street from Mount St. Vincent College.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So all we see are trees. It's a lovely way to live in New York.
That's really
large
wonderful.
Backyard with a big bedrock in the bedrock of New
and
York.
And you've been there for quite a while then.
We've been there a decade.
How long does it take you to get to Columbus Circle?
By car, 15 minutes.
By public transport?
By public transportation, a half hour, 40 minutes.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah,
that sounds like perfect.
Yeah.
Is that the way your life is, perfect?
No.
Well, I mean,
it actually used to take me longer. When I lived on 19th Street on the west side.
Right.
It would take me longer to get to the restaurants on the Upper West Side from there than it does from where I live now.
Isn't that something? Well,
well
there's a lesson in there somewhere, there isn't there? It seems to me you've learned a lot of lessons. What about education? Did you go to school and things?
Went to Syracuse. Went to the Newhouse School of Communications.
Oh, did you? Yeah, okay.
You know?
Yeah.
And
you were studying communications.
Communications. Journalism.
Okay, journalism and communications.
Yeah. And I came out and I started at Time Inc., which there was no better place to start
really?
For a young journalist. And
what
I was
year were that? I don't mean to, but what year?
1972.
Boy, that was just when everything's happening. I got a great feel for that period.
I was the youngest reporter that life ever had. And I walked in the door, and they started sending me all over the country. You know, they just said, if you're here, we think you can do it. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here.
Okay. Uh-huh.
And so one of my first assignments was they sent me, they said, go spend 2 weeks with Muhammad Ali.
My
and
God.
And then 2 weeks with Joe Frazier.
Wow. Oh,
so
wow.
Those were the kind of stories that
help me out.
That
was that before the thing down with
at the
Liston?
Garden.
No, that's
no,
after
no,
Liston.
No, Liston was 1964 in Florida.
Okay. I wasn't
this
that
was,
in
this was in preparation for the first fight at the Garden.
Okay, right. Okay. Yeah, that was a biggie. He was in the... I had a friend who was his friend. He won in 60 the gold, Cassius Clay.
In Rome.
And I had a friend, I think he won the bronze or something. Then he came to call Robert Muhammad.
Uh-huh.
He was Robert Owens out of Jamaica, heavyweight. And he was a good friend of his. And he remembered recounting to me when that fight took place because they were in the New. There were a whole lot of people in the New Yorker and everything. And it was an exciting time.
Muhammad Ali was...
He was a piece of work.
The most charismatic human being I've ever met.
Really? Did you come to know him well or
no?
Mm-hmm. Not like a Hamish.
I came to know him.
Okay.
And I'll tell you a fast story. And it was funny, a couple years ago, I can't think of the fighter, but Jose Torres, before he died, I was at a party and I walked over to him and I said, Jose, you don't remember me, but we spent a night together And he said, I remember you. He said, he called his wife over, and he said, remember that I was telling you about? He was there. We were all out for dinner and in Miami, and an elderly Jewish man came over and looked at him, and he said, I hope Joe Frazier beats you. and Ali goes into his act. Yeah. You what? You what? Hold me back, Jose. Hold me back. And Jose Torres grabs him. And, oh, I'm going to whoop you. I'm going to do that. And this man's wife is going, oh, what have you done? Right, you got him so angry, the whole thing. And anyway, so the restaurant we were at, there was a stairway with the...
Should have had that on tape. It was an Academy Award.
The story just
gets
better.
Right out of life. Academy Award, yeah.
There was a stairway, and they, and he was at the top, this guy, and Ali's shaking his hand at him. The next thing I know, and this poor woman, his wife, is dying.
Yeah, sure.
And the next thing I know, we're on the causeway, and we somehow we're in front of them. And this is Muhammad Ali training for the fight of his life.
Yeah, right, absolutely.
He's leaning out the door of the limousine, shaking his fist. The drawbridge goes up. He gets out of the car. He starts banging on the hood of the. This guy is dying. I'm gonna whoop you. I'll let you whoop me. The whole thing.
Oh, he was serious.
Oh,
he was
no,
no, he wasn't.
He was never serious.
He wasn't.
And
what happened? Where's
Angelo
the line
Dundee?
Between when you get serious and
like
that? You know what I mean?
Angelo Dundee, his manager, got out
Huge,
of the and invited these people. Said, "We're going for dessert to Wolfie's. Come with us."
Yeah, yeah.
We all went to dessert. At the end of the evening, this guy stood up. And walked over to him and kissed him.
I'll be damned.
And said, when this night started, I hated you, and now I love you.
Do you know that that should have all been on tape? Because it would best any movie that was ever made in Hollywood with all the backing and so forth out of real life. That would have been an Academy. If you had the lighting right and everything, if you had it like that, it would be like that. Now, authentic, real authentic human behavior and everything like that. So you got to writing. Did I hear you say you went right out of school, Syracuse, to Time Warner? Was that the magazine, or you were writing? You were writing.
I actually went out and was a page at NBC for a while, and I gave the guided tour.
Oh,
this
I remember.
Studio 3B, the home of the Tonight Show, starring Johnnie Cochran.
Right.
And then I.
But as a career, you got to Time Incorporated.
Yeah, that was my first real job.
And they were on 6th Avenue then?
They were on 6th Avenue
and
50th Street.
And you had Time Incorporated then, and then you had. Did you know there was Gerald Levin was there? And you were a writer. You were writing.
I was a reporter.
You were a reporter for Time Magazine.
For Life Magazine.
Life Magazine,
yes.
Oh. Photographs.
We had Life Magazine had, at that point, arguably the best writing staff any magazine had ever put together.
Why do I think Life photos as opposed
well,
to Time?
Well, because it was an unbelievably magnificent photo magazine.
Right,
we had the best photographers in the world also.
Okay, that's a good combo, isn't it?
But the writing staff was underrated, but after the magazine closed, every one of those writers went on to become a best-selling writer.
Really?
Every
including yourself? Yeah?
Including myself.
How many were there then?
There was probably 12 writers on the staff, but it was... Tommy Thompson, who wrote Hearts, and Shauna Alexander, Jane Howard.
And you guys still ever get together and everything?
Well, I was the young one. I wasn't really the, I was the reporter. They were the writers.
Okay.
So.
You were the only reporter?
No, we had a bunch of reporters.
A bunch of reporters.
But the young people started as reporters.
Yeah,
and that
was, that's the way it worked.
And
that
was me.
Okay, that was good. So. You got to start like that, and you started writing. When did you first get the idea of doing a book? Which was the first book? And maybe you could take, maybe we could tick off. 15 or 17 actual best-selling books you've written that appeared best-selling books on the New York Times list, the singular list probably in the country.
Yep.
That's a hell of an achievement. Maybe you could tick them off a little bit, and then we'll come out of that ticking off process, including the other books that weren't bestsellers and so forth, back to when you wrote the first one, and then we want to get down to how you decide what happens, how's the business work, and all that, okay?
Well, most of those books were collaborations.
Okay.
I did a couple books with George Burns that were both number one.
Oh, my God.
The baseball umpire Ron Luciano and I did several books that were big bestsellers. I wrote Johnnie Cochran's autobiography.
My Lord.
Kary Bradshaw, the football player, and I had a couple of bestsellers. I did a reference book that was on the reference books. I created a reference system called What's What, which was basically if you didn't know the name of something, this would enable you to find it. It sold more than a million copies around the world.
Was it a big like thing, like a dictionary?
Yeah,
it
was.
I had a friend
who called it the visual dictionary.
Did you ever see a visual dictionary? Yeah. Why visual? Well, I mean, what you're talking about?
Well, the way we
matters. You're not talking about images or something.
Oh, it was all images. Images. Names. Yeah.
That's really important.
Well, we created
images associated with names.
We created the reference system. If you didn't know how to,
that's really important.
If you didn't know how to find that little,
right,
plastic piece at the end of your shoelace, there was no way to find it.
Uh-huh.
And we created the reference system that simply you know it's part of a shoe. So you look up shoe, you turn to the page, there's the shoe, and there's the identification.
That's a huge scholarly thing because that's like a that's like an epistemology or a way of putting a grid on reality that is going toward visual. I had a dear friend of mine, a guy named Steve Glazier, who wrote and put together a book all on his own, autodidactic, all kinds of pink slips about the idea. It was called The Word Menu.
Mm-hmm.
And he put out a word menu where he put a grid on the human language. We have Dewey Decimal, Library of Congress to get at things, but he put a grid on the human language according to his own categories. And it's putting a grid on it, and he had it there. It was called The Word Menu. William Safire said it was the most important thing since Roget.
Wow.
Which is quite a compliment from somebody who's so linguistic.
Yeah.
But you weren't familiar with that. It's still there. Then it became software.
Yeah.
And it became into the thing. He passed in a very tragic way. Got everything done. Got the galleys done. He had the galleys under his chest. And he finally got the publisher the best, Random House, for lexicography and so forth. Got it to the publisher. Went down to a vacation in Mexico, get ready for the spring tour where the book was going to come out, saw the cover of the book and everything, then he got a damn brain tumor and died at 42.
Mm.
But he put that together. The point being is he put a grid on reality. That's very, very important.
Well, the way we did it,
the same, apparently.
The way we did it is we extracted every noun from a dictionary.
Okay.
And we categorized them.
Okay.
And we found out there were, you could probably have 14 or 16 very broad categories.
Okay.
And almost without exception, everything fit into those categories.
Really?
And,
okay.
And then we went ahead and created those categories and put everything in. And
Nouns.
Yeah. Every noun.
Uh-huh.
And went from there. And it's a reference system that really got picked up. I mean, other people then followed.
And
that.
You published that as a book?
That was published as a book.
Was it like a dictionary?
It was a big, big book.
Yeah, big book. Is it still out and about?
You know, it's not.
Did it get over into software on the internet?
It did. Well, no, it didn't get into. Yes, early on it did. Early on. But what happened is the book was so successful that other companies did their own versions and spent a lot more money than we had.
Mm-hmm.
There is the Macmillan Visual Dictionary. Mm-hmm. Which is a beautiful book. Facts on File did their version of it.
Mm-hmm.
So there was, it was done better, but it was our system. And our book was the bestseller.
When you say our, were you the lead in that, or was there
somebody
you were
co-working with?
I did it with
a wonderful friend of mine.
Or how was it? You have to set up a whole topology of the language. How 14 categories. You don't have to remember in a rough way how the nouns would break down into 14 categories.
Well, it was
categories.
Transportation, communication, shelters.
Yeah.
Clothing,
you
know, it was
and
things
came
like
up
that.
With 14, you're putting a grid on reality in that, like Roget, or like you know, a thing like my friend. Okay, that's really and that sold well, right? When did that come out?
1984.
That would have been about when you could look up Word Menu when you get a chance.
I will.
It's out, and it's still there, and everything like that. But anyway, that's really interesting. And how? And you wrote all these books, and they were bestsellers. That must be very. Let's get back. You've written a number of others,
dozens of others
that weren't the best sellers.
Right.
Those were some of the top ones in terms of the hit list, like, and that. And you've been writing ever since you came out of Syracuse, I guess, right? You're a writer primarily. You think of yourself as a writer.
Not primarily, completely.
Completely, okay.
That's all I do.
But you're blending over into, it seems to me, with some of the work you're doing, into a multimedia world, which begins to get over into not just the writing, not the linear, but visual and getting into that. Because there are movie options are becoming part of the overall pattern. Multimedia is expanding so rapidly. I understand you just got back from London and visit with some people who put up a major multimedia thing. Your program is going to be streamed to the internet and be able to be seen without writing. It's all talk and multimedia and so forth. So you're interested in the whole communications ball.
Well, I think you have to be.
Yeah, okay, increasingly, because it's moving that way, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. if you're going to survive in this world, mm-hmm. you can't just continue to do the same things you've been doing forever.
You know, could I share something with you just to see what you think? I did a program way back in the beginning when we were just, you know, everything in public. I was a professor and we did this thing in Fuller, I liked, McLuhan and all that. But we did a program with a prince. He was the fourth son of, we had a great big deck. You will remember me, or I'm not sure if you, a big, 100 pounds with the case and everything. He had to haul this thing in to make a video program with somebody, and he was Ibn Saud's fourth son, major one in the Ibn Saud family in terms mm-hmm. of that, one of the most erudite men I've ever in my life met. And we had done a program then with Gilbert Grosvenor, who was then the head of this National Geographic, gotten along well. We did it with him, and I had some guy with me working the camera who was sort of almost like a hippie type or something. But anyway, they lost the video in the last 8 minutes of the program. So we didn't have anything with the Saudi Arabian prince. He was so erudite and so bright that so we had to get foot. And I called Mr. Grosvenor, and he said, "Don't tell anybody, but you come on over, and we've got a lot of footage of Saudi Arabia you can fill with images for that back last 8 minutes or so. But don't tell anybody. We'll give you an editor." And he did. God bless him and everything. But anyway, the point being, we then got thinking of multimedia and that, and we made a transcript. We did an audio track of the voice on the tape, and then visual. And we had people look at it. I forget how well we put it together. They have a different take on it. The famous one was Nixon and Kennedy in the first presidential election. People who saw it on television had a whole different take than the people who saw it, you know, by the traditional means of that. And so the multimedia, they had a whole different thing. It's a long-winded story. The multimedia is a different thing, a different experience than the linear perception that Mr. McLuhan used to talk about. And the medium is the message and so forth.
Well, I mean, the simple answer
is closer to reality.
The simple answer is the feeling you get being in the movies, as it being physically in a movie theater, mm-hmm. as opposed to watching exactly the same movie at home. Even now with large screen TVs.
Yeah, tell me.
I personally enjoy the experience of being communal. Uh-huh. Watching a movie in the theater, smell the popcorn, get my feet stuck to the floor.
Yeah, right.
You know, I mean, I enjoy that, and it's a very different experience.
It is, yeah.
And you probably see the film somewhat differently than you do at home.
That's what I was trying to get at in a certain sense.
Well, you know, as you've said, we were talking before, Marshall McLuhan had it right. The medium is the message. We give a certain amount of weight. Mm-hmm. to the communications device, mm-hmm. the computer, or seeing something on a computer and seeing something on television, we give them different weight in our minds.
And we get a different reaction of a sensory perception. Mm-hmm. And as we walk through life, it's multisensorial. I mean, we experience the world multisensorially. And then when but we haven't had any of that historically. It wasn't until we finally got a film thing way back 19th century. Writing, or we had different ways we could write, or we could do cuneiform, or they could write things down and they could convey it and that sort of thing.
Well, you know, the world changes.
He called it linear.
Yeah, the world changes.
Linear thinking. Yeah, it changes exponentially now.
100 years ago, oddly, at the turn of the previous century, the automobile was invented and became accessible.
Right.
Automobile and then flight. Mm-hmm. And it changed the world. It changed the world in fundamental ways.
Absolutely.
For the first time, you actually could leave your town and go to another town easily.
Yeah, right.
Suddenly the world was bigger. Mm-hmm. 100 years later, the internet is invented.
Yeah.
Or accessible.
Yeah.
And the world expands again. Right. And now the world is instantly accessible.
A global village.
And what that means is fundamentally society is going to change in ways we can't even imagine.
Right.
And that's exciting.
Has changed, and is due for greater change as we look ahead. And you get into something that's beyond the hyperbolic curve. It gets to be exponential now. And they, I mean, are we in for an exponential transformation in terms of the evolution of 200,000 years of our existence?
How did readily access to transportation change the world? It changed society in
the
most
roads.
Fundamental. Well, of course, but it changed society in the most fundamental ways. It changed relationships between people.
Absolutely.
It expanded horizons. Mm. It made a new kind of communication possible.
Right.
Because if I wanted to talk to you, mm-hmm. I could get to you. I didn't have to write you a letter that would take a week to get there.
Took 3 months for Ben Franklin to London.
Yeah. So.
Now it's a nanosecond.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
so that's
going to
change things in ways I don't think we can even imagine, or certainly I can't.
And who was it? Was it, I forget who, we shape our tools and thereafter our tools shape us. We do that. I'm not sure who that was, but anyway, they did that. And we're in that kind of a situation now. How do you decide what it is you're going to write about? You've written on so many different things. You've done a lot of co-writing.
Yeah.
How does co-writing work? Is that different than being up in the garret doing your own thing right out of your own mind?
You know,
you're a serious writer. Explain some of that to us.
Basic philosophy is this is my job.
Okay.
And I think 50 years from now, 100 years from now, mm-hmm. maybe there'll be 4, 5, 6 writers that work in my lifetime that people will be still reading. So for me, I've been very fortunate to make my life as a writer,
mm-hmm.
to experience an unbelievable array of things.
Mm-hmm.
But I've always seen it as a job. And so when something comes along that interests me, I say, that's what I want to know. I want to know more about that. Or if something comes along that's going to pay very well.
What's the dynamic between those two impulses in your consciousness? How much does the market divide it? How much do you have to be concerned with what the market predicts for your material well-being? And how much is that going to be relevant to the ongoing evolution of human society, that people will be able to do what it is they want to do rather than what a market says they should do in order to have a life that they would like to, I don't want to use the word compromise, what they would really like to be doing in order to, you know, that kind of thing. Is that ever going to change?
Well,
the
reality of it is I am doing what I want to do.
Okay.
So I've never wanted to do anything else but what I'm doing.
Okay.
Shakespeare said,
We've
always got a
pretty good writer.
There's never a show that doesn't go on. But Shakespeare said, "Anyone who writes for anything but money is a fool." Now that's Mr. Shakespeare. So that's
also Shakespeare's time.
You know,
that's also Shakespeare's time.
But what it has enabled me to do mm-hmm. is dip into worlds for 6 months, for a year that are fascinating. For example, I happen to be friends with Donnie Brasco, Joe Pistone.
Okay.
And although I did not write that book,
mm-hmm.
and he said to me at one point, is there anything at the FBI that you'd be interested in seeing?
Uh-huh.
And I said, you know what, I'd like to go into the crime lab. So the FBI I was the first reporter ever to have complete access to the FBI crime lab.
Wow.
And
any restrictions put on you?
I spent 6 months.
No, but any restrictions put on what you could report or
say
writing? Okay.
Okay, and this was, in fact, I do feel in a lot of ways responsible for the whole explosion of interest in forensic science.
Okay.
I spent 6 months in there and did a book. And then went to every single cable channel that might be right for it. I went to Discovery, I went to A&E, I went to what was then Court TV, mm-hmm. I went to every one of them trying to sell a half-hour show about forensic science.
From the book? The book is
from
already
book.
Written and out?
From the book.
Is it out?
Yeah.
Is it published?
Yeah.
Okay.
And
what'd you get?
And every one of them, without exception, turned me down.
Okay.
And then went ahead and did the show themselves.
I just stole the idea.
Yeah, the new detectives, the forensic files, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. the new FBI. Every one of them did the same show that I had pitched.
Could you have done a better show than they?
No.
Okay.
No.
That's an interesting dynamic, isn't it?
No.
In terms of the evolving society.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, okay. Could I have done a show?
The writer is not the skill of the director.
Could I have done as good a show?
Yeah.
Sure. I mean, I don't think I created the format.
Yeah.
And
a lot of writers will write, Steinbeck or something, and then they make a movie of it, and they're very disappointed because they don't get the nuance the way they write it. That's a dynamic tension, right? And intellectually, or sometimes big egos and that kind of stuff get involved too.
Well, right? The first novel I wrote was made into an action adventure film.
Which one was that?
Nothing you've ever heard of. It was called The Pack, about a pack of wild dogs.
Uh-huh.
And it was shown at one point in the London Film Festival.
The film. Now you're talking a film.
The film version
you
of this
did a
book
film.
That we wrote.
I
didn't do it. It was.
Oh, they took the book.
Yeah,
did
a lot
you cooperate
of my books.
With the director? What's the relationship between you creating the property? That's the property in the business world of music, and the director or the producer of that film or other films. And what's the dynamic between the writer, creator of the property, and the rest of the industry of multimedia presentation of ideas to influence consciousness?
It's very important. Mm. I cash the check.
Okay, that's good. You got a good check.
That's it.
Okay.
And they, one of the things about when about the film industry, when they buy a book, they buy the book, and they're pretty much free to do whatever they want to do with it.
That's the way it should be, do you think? Do you think the author?
I think
back to that question again of the money.
Yeah.
Now the money is probably, if we look at world society, I guess there's lots of things. There's love, there's devotion, there's all kinds of human emotions and human motivations and so forth. But the main one, it seems to me, that holds world society together is money. Is there anything more relevant to that in terms of determining human behavior, I wonder?
Boy,
what do you think?
Harold,
what
I don't think you're right.
You don't think I'm right?
No,
okay,
I really don't. I at least in my life, relationships.
Okay.
You know, if I had to sell a relationship, I wouldn't do it.
That's what I was going to get.
No,
Do
we have to pay the mortgage every month? You can't underestimate the importance of money. But would I betray a friendship for money?
People do all the time.
But I don't.
No. Okay. Good. Okay.
You
that's
know,
important.
And,
yeah.
And
so that's the grounding. Of,
yeah.
In
so
principle, yeah.
You know, I don't think. At least for me, and I can say for most of the people in my world, money is certainly a desirable commodity, but it's not the motive. It's not the foundation of my life.
Okay, that's an important question. It's an ethical thing and
sure.
a moral thing and all that kind of thing. And we certainly don't want to think that we're so outer directed to a thing that isn't relating to what we really want to do.
And when I talk about money,
when I talk about
money for books, it's important, it's vital, it's essential, but it's not all of it. In other words, I would turn down the wrong project for the right money.
Would you turn down the right project?
I've done things I wanted to do for a lot less money than.
You're getting on the horns of the dilemma of an ethical way in which society is going to organize itself, you know. That's a big question still before us, and whether or not we have a system. Also, is it accepted that there has to be that dynamic between, why is it, you said, I don't know if you used the term, maybe it was the person I was just talking to, autodidact, you're familiar?
Mm-hmm.
Self-taught.
Mm-hmm.
Also, another thing I just move off, I did a program once with the smartest person in the world, Marilyn Mock, Beau Savant. She
uh-huh.
was the smartest IQ in the history of the universe and everything. And they had done surveys about the smart IQ. IQ is one thing, there's love and all kinds of other things. But IQ, the smartest people in the world in terms of a class are writers. The smartest people.
So I would agree with that, of course.
No, but I mean, they get to that point. But whether or not this dilemma of autodidact, you're teaching yourself, you're doing what you want. You could be going, education, we have a big paradigm in terms of education. Education in the minds of many people used to be in Dickens' day, do what you are told, it's Marshall. Do what you are told, learn things that you have to learn, prerequisite after prerequisite, specialize, all these kind of things. An autodidact is somebody who just pursues what they're really interested
in,
like in a free way, rather than being dictated to by an institutional structure that requires them, in order to have bread to eat, to do something. How are you going to justify somebody standing there turning nuts on an assembly line in a Ford plant to turn out a Ford car? It can't be justified in terms of, do you understand what I'm saying?
Sure.
Okay. I still think it's a major problem confronting humanity about how they're going to get demand and ability to deal with the material world by doing what they want to do, like a poet.
Well,
they all suffered and starved.
You know, we are not a society in which people have the luxury of doing what they want to do.
Do you think we ever will be?
I don't think any society in history has
no,
ever
no,
done
no,
that.
No, history is a nightmare from which I'm attempting to awaken.
Yeah, well, you know...
Do you think we may be awakening from a history of injustice and compromise being forced upon the serfs on the feudal estates where the kings lived well and so forth? Or is that too grim a reading of history?
Well, I think you have to deal with reality. And reality,
well, okay.
The first essence of life is survival.
And That's the beginning point, isn't it? Yeah.
It is this quest for survival is probably the only universal feeling that all living things have.
That's right. 99.9% of all species that ever existed have gone extinct.
Insects who do not have a functioning thought process.
Yeah. Fertile.
Have a sense of survival.
Yeah.
They will flee from danger.
Yeah, right.
And so you start with that. So you talk about your serfs.
Yeah.
Did they want to be serfs? Probably not.
Probably not.
But they did want to survive.
To be a slave. So, you're a slave. You adjust to it.
You get food and you do what you have to do.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That's the history of things. Yeah.
So, but how you know, you, in yeah. my career,
yeah.
the you know, in terms of doing what you want to do, what's been for... What's been fortunate about that is I've written about so many different subjects.
Yeah, that's what I wanted to ask you.
That I've been able to pursue things that are fascinating.
That's great.
I've been, you know, when I was with Johnnie Cochran, I was a lawyer.
Yeah.
And I was in the middle of the Simpson trial.
Yeah.
You know, and the FBI right. crime lab. I did a project about biotech.
Right.
And so I learned about biotech. Right. I did a book with a Nobel Prize winner, probably the man who has changed the world more than anyone else, named Kary Mullis, invented the polymerase chain reaction.
Polymers, is it to do with plastics or something?
No.
No, polymers.
No, it was a way of replicating DNA, creating more DNA in an hour than you would ever need. And every advance in DNA chemistry that has taken place in the last two decades... Uh-huh. Has taken place because of Kary.
No kidding.
Still the most valuable patent in the world. $3 billion a year.
Really interesting.
And
have you had your DNA analyzed?
I have. Well,
I've just sent mine off last week.
So
I'm going to be interested to see how it comes back. Are you going to do that? It's interesting.
I'm going to do my kids.
Oh, are you?
I'm going to do my kids. My two kids are adopted.
Yeah.
And we'd like to know what the heritage
is. But you want to know yours too, you know.
Well,
you're not curious about your own background?
Middle European.
Middle
to Eastern European.
Like you can do that. We couldn't have done that 100 years ago. Things are changing very rapidly. Yeah. How do you select? You said I can write on what I'm interested in.
Yeah.
Do you know something? I got a real problem with that because I'm virtually interested in everything.
Well, I've been
fortunate. You know what I mean?
I've been fortunate enough to write about.
How do you pick and choose? If you're going to get focused on one thing, how are you going to stay? How are you going to not lose focus on all the other millions of things that are going on that are incredibly interesting? Particularly if you get into the nuance of emotion.
Obviously, you can't do everything. So things come along.
Yeah, yeah.
This is a book that's coming out.
Let me hold it up.
These are the galleys. This is
the recent book.
It's coming out.
It's coming
not out
now.
Yet.
And this is a person that's Deepak Chopra, right?
It's Deepak Chopra's brother, believe it or not.
Oh, is it his brother?
Who is the head of continuing medicine at Harvard Medical School.
Okay.
So his job is to teach 60,000 to 70,000 doctors every year.
Mm-hmm.
What's going on in medicine?
I don't know if they've been. I guess you can see this.
So,
okay.
Anyway, so what this book is?
I don't know.
Is this book will tell you?
Yeah.
We are inundated with medical information.
Right. Yeah.
And nobody knows what's true, what's not true, real, what's not real. This book kind of will teach you how to separate what's real from what's not real.
Yeah. Very important.
But in doing it.
Uh huh.
We use 40 different chapters about the biggest controversies in medicine.
Right.
In doing it, I have learned so much about the world, about the world of medicine, about everything from Let me ask you a question, Harold.
Anything at all. I'm up for anything.
How many cups of coffee do you drink every day?
More than I should. I would say maybe four or five, something like
that. Why do you think that's more than you should?
Well, I don't know, because they tell me that I shouldn't drink
who
as much
coffee.
I should drink chamomile tea. All the people from the nature side of things and everything. And
let
I
me
just,
tell you something.
Here's
something I learned in this book. The more coffee you drink every day, the better it is for you.
Is that
coffee,
true? Everybody, listen. Everybody,
coffee,
Link, go out and drink coffee.
Coffee is amazing.
Is it really?
It's amazing what it will do. It'll lower your cholesterol. It'll prevent liver cancer. There's a whole long list of things you can do. And the interesting thing is, it's the same. Apparently, you get the same results from both caffeinated and decaffeinated coffee.
No kidding. What is it that does it?
Nobody knows.
Oh, really?
This goes back to an epidemiological study that they started conducting in 1947.
I'll be damned.
They've more than a million people, the Kaiser Permanente study.
That's a lot, yeah.
And this is what they've drawn from this.
Isn't that
the book is just full of great stuff like that. We all know a low-dose aspirin every day is great for heart attacks, right? But it will also prevent colon cancer.
It will?
Absolutely.
Why have low dose only? Why not regular aspirin?
Well, regular aspirin apparently will do the same thing, but aspirin can be destructive to your stomach lining.
Okay, yeah, right.
So you don't want to take too much of it.
Oh, right, yeah, right.
You know?
Okay,
so we went through, all of the controversial topics. I learned so much about
medicine. And
I loved every minute
like
of it.
You're like a hound dog on, if you're going, you're really interested. It's really inherently interesting. You're interested and it's exciting. You're some new things you're learning all the time.
I did a book.
And that's a wonderful state of mind to be in, don't you think?
I did a book.
Everybody should be in that state of mind, running down things that they're really interested in themselves.
How lucky
rather
I am.
Than doing something rote.
How lucky I am.
Okay, and then you can write and translate that.
Yeah.
One other thing, we have a person here, Paula Glory, one of the producers. Have you run into the hemp oil stuff yet? Hemp oil, marijuana, is very, very, very concentrated cannabinoids. Mm-hmm. It's very beneficial medically.
You want to
know? Cures cancer.
Do you want to know something?
That's something that ought to get out.
Let me tell you something, Harold.
Yeah.
There is absolutely no scientific evidence that that's true.
Okay, that's good you say that.
It's in the book.
We do a whole
chapter on marijuana, on the medical benefits of marijuana. And as much as I wish it was true, it isn't.
Rick Simpson stuff and all that you went into.
There's just no scientific evidence.
Is that really true, right?
No scientific evidence. It will temporarily be very helpful for glaucoma, but there are other things that will be more helpful over a prolonged period.
Yeah. Yeah, not smoking it, but a hemp oil where it's concentrated.
Hey,
did you get to that?
No.
Okay.
We didn't get
Maybe
into that. We're talking about medical marijuana.
Yeah, medical marijuana, but this is the concentrated thing where they get it. It's done. Maybe we could send a link to you about that because there's a lot coming up.
I'd love to see this.
That's another subject you might go down.
I would love to see the
You're
real
too damned
studies.
Interesting. You've written on too many things. You've got such an interesting life. It's too hard. We've got to get it all into an hour. You can't do that. One of the things we have a little clip that maybe you wanted to show or.
Well, one
or
of the
could
places I've been. Sure. One of the things I've written a lot of humor.
Yeah,
I've been very fortunate to write a lot of humor.
Sense of humor. It goes with the territory, I think.
And I did a couple of parodies of the chicken soup books.
Oh, yes, right.
And mine was the cynical version.
Okay. Oh, cynical
thing. And mine was called Chicken Poop.
Okay, right. Okay.
And those books did extremely well.
Uh-huh. Did they sell well? They sold
extremely well, and still are available. Chicken Poop for the Soul.
Did you say a series? There was more than
There were two. First one was so successful that we did a second one.
Yeah, sure.
In fact, the books were so nice that the person who created the Chicken Soup series, when he lectured, began the lecture by reading one of the stories from my book.
I see.
This clip is... there were several plays and movies done from this, and this is just a little clip about the true meaning of love. We don't have
the
to.
The true meaning
we don't
of
have
love.
To,
that's right.
You know.
Well, let's set it. We're going to run three or four or five minutes of it
enough.
And everything. We're talking with David Fisher, writer extraordinaire, if I may say so. We're going to get to read and so forth.
Great.
So, But if we can set that up, here it goes. The meaning, the true meaning of love. Let's not talk, the mics are open.
I learned the meaning of true love on a street corner. It was a corner that I passed each day on my way home from work. And often, coming from the opposite direction, I saw the most beautiful girl in the world. On occasion, our eyes would meet as we passed, and she would demurely look away. For months, neither one of us dared speak to the other one. As those months sped by, toward the end of each day, I actually found myself watching the clock, just counting the moments until I could see my mystery woman again. I even began leaving the office just a couple minutes early. But I waited on her corner until I saw her in the distance. Only then would I start to cross. To my amazement, I realized I was falling in love with her. Finally, one magnificent fall day, I summoned the courage to speak to her. I waited on her corner. I was so nervous, just the butterflies, you know. She walked towards me, and well, I walked towards her. I walked right up to her, and I said, "Excuse me, but..." "Yes?" Before I could finish, she replied, "I'm sorry, I have to go meet my husband." And she walked on. She was married. I was shattered. Suddenly, the days at work seemed endless. They droned on and on. You know, I even started walking on the other side of the street, watching her in the distance. My fantasy had been destroyed. But then one day, I realized how silly I had been. How wrong. I mean, just because she was not free to love me, I had stopped loving her. I'd fallen into a terrible trap, you see. I realized that my love for her had been dependent on her returning those feelings. On that day, I understood that true love is unconditional. The healthy expression of true love does not require anything in return. And I was in love with her. That day, I watched the clock with excitement. I raced to our corner, and I waited for her. I had spent too much of my life refusing to love another person until I could be sure that my love would be returned. I mean, that wasn't love. I realized that was just simply a form of narcissism. So, when she passed, well, I just turned around and I followed her. I followed her through the streets and all the way to just the cutest little house in the suburbs. Well, then I turned around and went home. I began following her every day. After a while, I even started standing across the street from her house, watching her in the window. She was so beautiful. It didn't matter to me that she didn't love me. Anyone can love a person who loves them back. I was expressing a much truer love. One freezing cold day, she came out to get her mail. And she saw me standing there in the front yard. And then she came right up to me. And she said, "Please leave." I couldn't believe it. That's when I knew. That is when I knew that she really cared about my well-being. Oh, God. She was so cute. This nice, striped little sweater. She sent some other stuff, but I was on cloud nine. I couldn't make it out, really. And she went back inside, and... Well, that was it for me. I loved her more than ever. As winter turned to spring, I came back every day, day after day. Then one night, she called the police. And they warned me to stay away from her. I just smiled. And they didn't understand. How could they? They didn't know what we had with one another. What kind of weak love, I wondered, should so easily be deterred by the cold hand of government? True love, I knew, could not so easily be surrendered. Then a few days later, a big man came out of the house. I guessed it was her husband. And he punched me several times. This, I understood, was simply a test of my love. Each blow just seemed to strengthen my love for her, as they served to prove the depth of my feelings. 2 often in life, I had allowed embarrassment or discomfort to force me to hide my feelings, but no more. Oh, then there was that silly judge who thought that a piece of paper called a restraining order could keep me away. Were they crazy? I mean, if a piece of paper, if a flimsy piece of paper could keep me away, then what I was feeling could not possibly be true love. You know, many people would have stopped after that first arrest. But those people, well, they're like I once was. Dependent on the feelings of others to determine their own feelings. If my love could not survive a few weeks of separation, then it wasn't really love. It was infatuation, lust. So, on the day of my release, I returned to her house and I pitched my tent. The gunshots did frighten me, I admit. Was it possible, I wonder? Did I fall in love with a dysfunctional person? Was the woman I loved crazy? But then I realized that if I allowed a few of her shortcomings to change my feelings, then what I was feeling could not possibly be true love. The most difficult test of my love came when they put me in the hospital. It's been, about 2 years now, and to be honest with you, at times I've wondered if I still love her. But I know that's exactly what they want me to think. I think about where she's at and what she's doing, and all the time that we spend with one another. I wonder if she thinks about us from time to time. Gosh, I do miss her. But then I remember that true love cannot be defeated by time or distance. True love is eternal. I know then that no matter how long they keep me locked away, no matter how long they test my resolve, the hour I am free, I will return to her side. For that is the meaning of true love.
is great. That's funny. That is so funny, man. That's beautiful. That's really funny.
The whole book stories.
Oh, that's
like
wonderful.
That.
Yeah. If you turn
Reader's Digest inside out.
Okay. Wonderful. And the question I have is, that was not reading. Nobody was standing there reading it. It was worked out in a multimedia way with great talent, music, underpoint. This is really a clip that is of great significance, and in terms of incorporating your ideas, where did the script come from?
Oh, that script was is it the all story.
Your, yeah, was
the
script it your is, book, yes. your yeah. script? Yeah. What was your role in creating this multimedia experience that can touch the thing?
I said they could do it.
You gave the property.
I gave them permission to do it.
And signed it over to them, and then they did the multimedia. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yep. That's so funny. I'm glad we got it all out for the people. That is really a riot.
They did
and
a
the
nice
book,
job.
I really want to get to the books and read them. I got to read your stuff. I'm sorry. The trouble is, I'm too many interesting things and everything. We've been talking. I really congratulate you on your life's work and all that sort of thing. Now, we're talking now on October 7, 2010. You've taken an interest, if it's okay with you, in another project. You're looking for another project, and it happens to do with our mutual friend, Reed Stowe.
Right.
And now maybe you could, how does it work? You're going to do it, you want to get the publication lined up. How does it work for somebody? And then also, if you could, how much is it becoming relevant, the movie option, on a particular story or something that you're putting together in terms of blending into this multimedia world that seems to be emerging before us? Fill us in for somebody who's had a lot of successful engagement of that dynamic.
Well, movie options are important.
Yeah.
You know, it is the, you know, publishing, movie publishing, it's the chicken and the egg. You know, generally, books are published first and movies come out of them, but often there's a movie interest, and which leads to great publishing interest.
Yeah.
Reed, for those people who don't know, Reed sailed his homemade 70-foot sloop for 1,152 days, the longest any human being in history, that's all history, has ever gone without touching land.
He did
it without being resupplied.
Right. Amazing.
And he also, the first 300 days, he was with a lovely woman who left the boat off the coast of Australia to go have their baby.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And 2 years later, when Reed landed in New York, Sonia and Darshan, their now two-year-old child, was there to meet him.
Mm-hmm.
It's an astonishing story.
It sure is.
Of perseverance.
Mm-hmm.
Of psychology, of the human spirit, and right now we are endeavoring to find the right publisher.
The right publisher among a number. How do you do? Do you?
Well, we've done a proposal.
You have contacts within the.
Well,
thing.
We have
you
an
have
agent.
A reputation.
We have an agent.
You have an agent that works on your behalf.
Yeah. And we.
Have you been with that same agent for a long time? How does that work for the writer?
I happen to be a little unique in that I work with several different agents.
You do.
Because I do a lot of collaborations,
so
I want agents to feel free to pick up the phone and call me. In fact, my primary agent at one point, I walked into a room and he said to me, "Well, look who's here. We were just talking about loyalty to agents."
Mm.
And I said to him, "Richard," I said, "how can you say that? I'm loyal to more agents than anyone in New York."
You're right.
So,
And you also have an association, if I might, with the Wolper family.
Well, David, I did David Wolper's autobiography.
Did you necessarily then come to know the person quite well?
I knew David. I wouldn't say well, but I knew him certainly. Liked him a lot.
You can do a biography without knowing them well. Okay, it's just another issue that we don't have time to go into. How well do you have to know? Because again, the whole life story, there's so many interesting things.
Well, you know what? When you're setting out to do someone's autobiography, particularly people who are well known.
Yes, and you've done many.
The goal is to create in the pages of a book the persona that the reader expects that when they buy a book about or by a celebrity, mm-hmm. they're doing it because they're interested or they like that celebrity.
Okay.
And so you have to sort of deliver what
right.
they expect. Let me give you an example. I did William Shatner's autobiography.
Wow, yeah, big. Yeah.
And we're in the middle of the first chapter, or second chapter. I pause in the book to let him sell something.
Uh-huh.
And when you go online
yeah.
And read the comments, there are people who didn't like it. Uh-huh. But the truth is, that's William Shatner.
Yeah, he's a
William
salesman.
Shatner
yeah.
is kind of this wonderful, smart, but he's a salesman.
Yeah, right.
And
right.
he's selling
like
his biggest his
yeah.
biggest product yeah. is William Shatner.
Right, right, right.
And so, in order to give people mm-hmm. the fun of William
yeah.
Shatner.
Yeah.
Who is a terrific person,
yeah,
by the
right,
way.
Yeah.
That was, and they either get the joke or they don't.
All right, and it's also authentic.
Well, it's not really authentic. It's a joke.
It is
it's
a joke.
Really? You know,
okay,
it's the,
okay,
it,
like
it's
the
universe,
like yeah. the meaning of love.
It's the universal joke
the
that we share.
Meaning. Yeah, right. Okay. Yeah.
Shatner is not really that person, but he made a living for a long
yeah.
time
well,
selling.
Yeah, that's also
and so,
that's part of the acting and of this the thing like that.
William
and
Shatner has
Reed,
always winks.
Reed's very. We only got a couple minutes left.
Sure.
We want to not forget you're working on that. And Reed is an authentic person. He's very authentic, a very honest guy. We've both met and know him very well. Wish
right.
him well. Then so you're going to write, you want to do that. The first thing for you to do is get in touch with the person who's going to publish the book. And is the book and the other auxiliary things that are going to come out of the book a part of the overall process that you deal with as you work with your agent to work with it? Or is it separate? Are they still separate, the publishing and the other auxiliary things that are, because with the internet and so forth coming, are they blending or what's the story? We only got a few minutes left. A minute.
You know, there's always the awareness
yeah.
that other opportunities are there.
Mm-hmm.
But it all starts for me with the book.
It all starts with the property.
You know,
okay,
with telling a story.
Yeah, and you don't write cinematographically. I did a thing with Alexandra Fuller, a writer. She wrote cinematographically.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, listen, one of the problems is, as we started out, you're interested, you're following your own interest, and I've got interest in everything. There's not enough time to cover everything that's of interest in this universe. You've done a marvelous job. Congratulations on the successful
Thank
writing
you,
career and so forth. All the best with the Stowe Project. And thanks a whole lot for coming in and sharing it. And the film is absolutely brilliant. It should be everywhere.
Yeah.
Thanks
thank
a
you.
Lot, David.
Harold, thank you so much
My
for having
great,
me.
My great, good pleasure. And it's your good pleasure to have had the perception. Then David Fisher, author extraordinaire, writer extraordinaire, sharing with us some of the joys of his having produced 17 best-selling books and dozens of others that are in his oeuvre, and he's working on this with Reed Stowe. I don't think you can do better than Reed, and so forth. And thanks a lot for sharing all this coming in.
My pleasure.
Please do tune in. We'll be coming back again tomorrow, and that's it for this particular program. Once more time, David Fisher, thanks a lot for participating and for all your good work over the years. Okay, see you tomorrow. Thanks.